Clarion Books and Harper Audio present Catherine Called Birdy by Karen Cushman. Performed by Mary Jane Wells. This book is dedicated to Leah, Danielle, Megan, Molly, Pamela, and Tama, and to the imagination, hope, and tenacity of all young women. Introduction by Linda Sue Park. Part of the fun of reading historical fiction is letting the story take us back in time to experience life in a different era. But what if we brought Catherine forward in time to today's world? What would be the best way to give her an idea of how we live now? We have to start by considering technology. Something as simple as a wall light switch would seem to her like magic, or perhaps witchcraft. After she got over her initial fright, she would probably want to flick it on and off a bunch of times, and we'd have to tear her away from it. Imagine trying to explain a smartphone. Would she even be able to comprehend the internet's ability to connect people across time and space? We'd need to take things slowly. I'm thinking that a cute baby animal video would be a good start. What should we do next? Maybe she'd like a little tour. We could go by car, or take a bus or a subway, all of which would require lengthy explanation. I personally hope that no airplane passes overhead while we're out and about. I would not be able to explain to her how an airplane gets off the ground. I would also strongly recommend reserving a discussion of space travel for another time. Catherine has a lively mind, so she's taken in all this strangeness, asking questions, trying to see everything at once. It's exhausting. She needs a break. So let's find somewhere to sit quietly for a while. How about an ice cream parlour for milkshakes? Specifically, chocolate milkshakes. Chocolate did not reach England until the 17th century, so Catherine has never had chocolate. I can't think of a better way to enchant her with our world. Amid all this strangeness, she will almost certainly be bewildered and in need of some reassurance. It would be comforting for her to learn that some things haven't changed much at all. We might tell her this. Catherine, many of your beloved saints are still commemorated in our day. You wrote about All Hallows' Eve on October the 31st. We sat up late tonight eating nuts and apples, watching the bonfires lit throughout the Shire to drive off witches and goblins. I think you would be puzzled by our Halloween traditions, the costumes, the trick-or-treating. Yet you would easily understand that the fascination with those same witches and goblins continues to this day. And you would recognise that your three-day celebration of All Hallows, All Saints and All Souls corresponds to the Mexican diaspora's Dia de Muertos, a connection that would transcend the language barrier. You learned about the saints from A Marvellous Small Book of Saints, Their Feast Days and Their Great Works. The book was a gift to your mother from the abbey where your brother Edward worked as a scribe. Books are a wonder and a treasure to you, because every one of them has to be literally written out by hand. Books with coloured illustrations are rarer still. Edward's passion is for the letters and the words. But for me, oh, the pictures. The birds and the flowers, the saints and the angels, the knights, squirrels and goats. You would love a visit to a library or bookstore, where there are so many books that you would think yourself in a place beyond heaven. You love pictures and drawing, so we might spend most of our time in the picture book section, where we'd make a special point of looking at books written and illustrated by women. For this, to me, is the essence of your story, how you face the limitations imposed on you. In 13th century England, the choices open to girls and women were severely circumscribed. Girls of every social class were expected to marry, keep house, and bear children. Those in the lower classes added farm chores or toil at the family's occupation. The idea of a woman having a career or profession or any kind of ambition beyond the family sphere would have been regarded as ludicrous at best, scandalous at worst. Little bird, you are bound by those social norms and feel the bindings keenly. We sense the indignation in your list of all the things girls are not allowed to do, from go on crusade and marry whom they will, to be alone and glide on the ice. Yet you had a good many advantages over most of the other girls and young women in your England. Your family had not one but two manor houses. You never lacked for food or shelter. You had a nurse, your beloved Morwenna, a cook, other servants. Some of your family members were educated. Most crucial of all, You are a member of the dominant culture in your society, which accords you privileges unknown to millions around the globe, both then and now. What do you do with those advantages? We seek your innate fairness and your attempts to seek justice many times throughout your story. Sometimes in small ways, as at the Bartlemas Fair, where you spend most of your money on gifts for other people. Or when you are unafraid to share food with the Jews you meet on their way to banishment from England. You rage when Geoffrey mocks Perkin, then stand up to the bully, despite having a crush on him. The choice that impresses me most is how you use the gift, a rare one for women in your time, of the ability to read and write. You pass that gift on to Perkin, then you magnify it with coin that buys not a promise, but the hope of a better future for him. And you use that gift to grow yourself, reading every book that comes your way, keeping your diary, composing lyrics and songs. When you write about your frustrations with your father and Robert and George and Alice, the time spent with your diary helps steady you. Putting on paper your anger and fear over being matched with Shaggy-Beard increases your courage and determination. Best of all, preserving in ink the moments of glee and contentment and happiness means you can relive them over and over, multiplying their pleasures. In our time as well, every one of us is limited in one way or another. You have shown us that while our daily lives might be subject to restrictions, our imaginations need not be, indeed must not be. Many of us are not writers, but it is imperative to ourselves and to humanity that we all find a means to widen our worlds and our hearts. By reading the words you have shared, we can learn to push back against injustice, use whatever privilege we have to reach out to others, and fill our days with honesty, fortitude, laughter, and love. No matter the centuries between your time and ours, your story gives us a light to live by.
September. 12th day of September.
I am commanded to write an account of my days. I am bit by fleas and plagued by family. That is all there is to say. 13th day of September.
My father must suffer from alehead this day, for he cracked me twice before dinner instead of once. I hope his angry liver bursts.
14th day of September. Tangled my spinning again. Corpus bones. What torture. 15th day of September. Today the sun shone and the villagers sowed hay, gathered apples and pulled fish from the stream. I, trapped inside, spent 2 hours embroidering a cloth for the church and 3 hours picking out my stitches after my mother saw it. I wish I were a villager. 16th day of September. Spinning. Tangled. 17th day of September. Untangled. 18th day of September. If my brother Edward thinks that writing this account of my days will help me grow less childish and more learned, he will have to write it. I will do this no longer, and I will not spin, and I will not eat. Less childish indeed. 19th day of September. I am delivered! My mother and I have made a bargain. I may forego spinning as long as I write this account for Edward. My mother is not much for writing, but has it in her heart to please Edward, especially now he has gone to be a monk, and I would do worse things to escape the foolish boredom of spinning. So I will write. What follows will be my book, The Book of Catherine, called Little Bird or Birdy, Daughter of Rollo and the Lady Ashlyn, Sister to Thomas Edward and the Abominable Robert, of the village of Stonebridge in the Shire of Lincoln, in the country of England, in the hands of God. Begun this 19th day of September, in the year of our Lord, 1290, the 14th year of my life. The skins of my fathers left over from the household accounts, and the ink also. The writing I learned of my brother Edward, but the words are my own. Picked off 29 fleas today. 20th day of September. Today I chased a rat about the hall with a broom and set the broom afire, ruined my embroidery, threw it in the privy, ate too much for dinner, hid in the barn and sulked, teased the littlest kitchen boy until he cried, turned the mattresses, took the linen outside for airing, hid from Moor Wenner and her endless chores, ate supper, brought in the forgotten linen now wet with dew, endured scolding and slapping from Moor Wenner, pinched Perkin and went to bed. And having writ this, Edward, I feel no less childish or more learned than I was. 21st day of September. Something is astir. I can feel my father's eyes following me about the hall, regarding me as he would a new war horse or a bull bought for breeding. I am surprised that he is not asked to examine my hooves. And he asks me questions, the beast who never speaks to me except with the flat of his hand to my cheek and my rump. This morning.
Exactly how old are you, daughter?
This forenoon.
Have you all your teeth? Is your breath sweet or foul? Are you a good eater? What colour is your hair when it is clean?
Before supper.
How are your sewing and your bowels and your conversation?
What is brewing here? Sometimes I miss my brothers, even the abominable Robert. With Robert and Thomas away in the King's service and Edward at his abbey, there are fewer people about for my father to bother, so he mostly fixes upon me. 22nd day of September. I am a prisoner to my needle again today, hemming linen in the solar with my mother and her women. This chamber is pleasant, large and sunny, with my mother and father's big bed on one side and on the other, a window that looks out on the world I could be enjoying were I not in here sewing. I can see across the yard, past the stables and privy and cowshed, to the river and the gatehouse, over the fields to the village beyond. Cottages line the dusty road leading to the church at the far end. Dogs and geese and children tumble in play while the villagers plough. Oh, would I were tumbling or even ploughing with them. Here in my prison, my mother works and gossips with her women, as if she didn't mind being chained to needle and spindle. My nurse, Mawenner, now that I am near grown and not in need of her nursing, tortures me with complaints about the lengths of my stitches and the colours of my silk and the thumbprints on the altar cloth I am hemming. If I had to be born a lady, why not a rich lady? So someone else could do the work and I could lie on a silken bed and listen to a beautiful minstrel sing while my servants hemmed. Instead, I am the daughter of a country knight with but 10 servants, 70 villagers, no minstrel, and acres of unhemmed linen. It grumbles my guts. I do not know what the sky is like today, or whether the berries have ripened. Has Perkins's best goat dropped her kid yet? Did Watt the farrier finally beat Sim at wrestling? I do not know. I am trapped here inside, hemming. Morwenna says it is the altar cloth for me. Corpus bones! 23rd day of September. There was a hanging in Riverford today. I am being punished for impudence again, so was not allowed to go. I am near 14 and I've never yet seen a hanging. My life is barren. 24th day of September. The stars and my family align to make my life black and miserable. My mother seeks to make me a fine lady, dumb, docile and accomplished, so I must take lady lessons and keep my mouth closed. My brother Edward thinks even girls should not be ignorant, so he taught me to read holy books and to write, even though I would rather sit in an apple tree and wonder. Now my father, the toad, conspires to sell me like a cheese to some lackwit seeking a wife. What makes this clodpole suitor anxious to have me? I am no beauty, being sun-browned and grey-eyed, with poor eyesight and a stubborn disposition. My family holds but two small manors. We have plenty of cheese and apples, but no silver or jewels or boundless acres to attract a suitor. Corpus bones! He comes to dine with us in 2 days' time. I plan to cross my eyes and drool in my meat. 26th day of September. Master Lackwit comes today, despite my mother's objections. Although she is wed to a knight of no significance, her fathers were kings in Britain long ago, she says. And my suitor is but a wool merchant from Great Yarmouth who aspires to be mayor and thinks a wife with noble relations, no matter how distant, will be an advantage. My father bellowed,
"Sweet Judas, lady! Think you we can eat your royal ancestors or plant your family name? The man stinks of gold. If he will have her and pay well for the privilege, your daughter will be a wife."
When there is money involved, my father can be quite well spoken. The hour of vespers later this day. My suitor has come and gone. The day was grey and drippy, so I sat in the privy to watch him arrive. I thought it well to know my enemy. Master Lackwit was of middle years and fashionably pale. He was also a mile high and bony as a herring, with gooseberry eyes, chin like a hatchet, and tufts of orange hair sprouting from his head, his ears, and his nose. And all his ugliness came wrapped in glorious robes of samite and ermine that fell to big red leather boots. It put me in mind of the time I put my mother's velvet cap and veil on Perkins Granny's rooster. Hanging on to the arm of Reese from the stables, for the yard was slippery with rain and horse droppings and chicken dung, he greeted us.
God forbid to you, my lord, and to you, Lady Esnett, I'm honoured to visit your bonus butter and beat the bedded.
I thought first he spoke in some foreign tongue, or a cipher designed to conceal a secret message, but it seems only that his nose was plugged. And it stayed plugged throughout his entire visit, while he breathed and chewed and chattered through his open mouth. Corpus bones! He troubled my stomach no little bit, and I determined to rid us of him this very day. I rubbed my nose until it shone red, blacked out my front teeth with soot, and dressed my hair with the mouse bones I found under the rushes in the hall. All through dinner, while he talked of his warehouses stuffed with greasy wool and the pleasures of the annual Yarmouth Herring Fair, I smiled my gap-toothed smile at him and wiggled my ears. My father's crack still rings my head, but Master Lackwit left without a betrothal. 27th day of September. Being imprisoned in the solar was none so bad this day, for I heard welcome gossip. My Uncle George is coming home. Near 20 years ago, he went crusading with Prince Edward. Edward came home to be king, but George stayed, finding other lords to serve. My mother says he is brave and honourable. My father says he is woolly-witted. Morwenna, who was nurse to my mother before me, just sighs and winks at me. Since my Uncle George has had experience with adventures, I am hoping that he can help me escape this life of hemming and mending and fishing for husbands. I would much prefer crusading, swinging my sword at heathens and sleeping under starry skies on the other end of the world. I told all this to the cages of birds in my chamber, and they listened quite politely. I began to keep birds in order to hear their chirping, but most often now they have to listen to mine. 28th day of September, Michaelmas Eve. Perkins says that in the village of Woodford near Lincoln, a man has grown a cabbage that looks like the head of St. Peter the Apostle. People are gathering from all over the shire to pray and wonder at it. My mother, of course, will not let me go. I had thought to ask St. Peter to strengthen my eyes, for I know it unattractive to squint as I do, and to make my father forget this marriage business. 29th day of September, Michaelmas, Feast of the Archangel Michael. Last night, the villagers lit the Michaelmas bonfires and set two cottages and a haystack afire. Cobb the smith and Beryl, John Atwood's daughter, were in the haystack. They are scorched and sheepish, but unhurt. They are also now betrothed. Today is quarter rent day. My greedy father is near muzzle-witted with glee from the geese. Silver pennies and wagon loads of manure our tenants pay him. He guzzles ale and slaps his belly, laughing as he gathers in the rents. I like to sit near the table where William the steward keeps the record and listen to the villagers complain about my father as they pay. I have gotten all my good insults and best swear words that way. Henry Newhouse always pays first, for at 30 acres, his is the largest holding. Then come Thomas Baker, John Swan from the alehouse, Cobb the smith, Walter Mustard, and all the 18 tenants down to Thomas Corter and the widow Joan Proud, who hold no land but pay for their leaky cottages in turnips, onions and goose grease. Perkin the goat boy holds no land either but pays a goat each year as rent for his grandmother's cottage. For weeks before Michaelmas, Perkin tells everyone in the village, "I will pay him any goat but not the black one, or not the grey one." William's steward, of course, hears and tells my father, and come rent day, my father insists on the black one or the grey one that Perkin did not wish to part with. My father gloats and thinks he is getting the best of Perkin, but Perkin always winks at me as he leaves. And each year the goat my father demands is the weakest or the meanest or the one that eats the laundry off the line or the rushes off the floor. Perkin is the cleverest person I know. 30th day of September. Morwenna says, when I have done...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.